Hello there, and welcome to Face to Face with the Federal Leaders. I'm Rosemary Barton. I'm here in the National Studio in Toronto. It is, as you probably all well know, the final week now of the federal election campaign. We have invited four people to speak to the leaders. They are all undecided and looking for answers ahead of voting day next week. Because of COVID, our audience has to be a virtual one. But no matter how we're connecting, we did want to make sure that this election is about you. And tonight, starting off our series, Conservative leader Erin O'Toole is joining us. Good to see you. Thank you for making the time.
Great to be here.
So let's get started right away. Here's our first voter.
Alligator pie. Alligator pie.
Hi, my name is Jason Hawkins. I'm 36 years old and I live in Toronto's Eglinton Lawrence riding. My wife and I are both high school teachers. However, this year she's not coming back to school as she'll be home with our recently born twins, Gordon and Viola, who are both 4 months old. This election, like previous elections, issues such as climate change and reconciliation will be big issues for me. But for the first time ever, the issue of childcare will also be a huge issue, helping decide who gets my vote.
All right, that's a household that doesn't probably sleep very much. Jason, it's over to you.
Hi, Mr. O'Toole. We are looking at a daycare bill in Toronto of upwards of $3,200 a month. That's not manageable for our family, and I can't imagine that being manageable for most Canadian families. So, Mr. O'Toole, what I'd like to hear from you is concrete solutions that your party is going to bring forward to deal with the growing cost of childcare, particularly in Canada's big cities.
Look, childcare is on the minds of all families, and we had our first child, Molly, when we lived in Toronto in the Beaches, and it took us months to actually find a spot for her so that Rebecca could return to the workforce. So I get it. What we're offering with our approach is a way to try and help all families directly through the tax system, giving them the flexibility to come up with what works best for them and their circumstances. With the lower income levels, the amount we want to help will represent about 75% of the cost based on a one child situation, of course, and it won't just come at tax time, it will be a benefit throughout the year so that there's that go-to support and it's immediate.
Jason, I'm gonna have a little go if you don't mind. I asked you this at the debate on Thursday night. I'm not sure I got an answer then either. I get what you're saying, that you want families to have choice, but in order to have choice, you also have to have things to choose. And your plan doesn't directly try to create spaces, which is also sort of the other part of this equation. Is there anything you could do to do that? Are you concerned that you're giving people money, but not actually giving them access?
Well, and this is a bit of an area that's not well understood. It will create more spaces. This is what the C.D. Howe Institute
just
studied.
By the market demand.
Just by providing more resources for families directly. Is every dollar tied to a space? No, it's tied to allowing the family to make the decision. Right. I'll often use the shift worker as an example. We've talked about our front lines, our nurses, our PSWs. They often will work evening shifts.
Sure.
So a spot in a school that won't be open, that's not a solution for a lot of families.
But you keep saying that it's a spot in a school. That's not what I understand the Liberal plan to be. The Liberal plan is to create a national child care program across the country. You say it's going to be sort of the market that will create the... How long is that going to take? Surely that's going to take just as long as the Liberals promised to create spaces over 5 years.
No, this is going to give families help now. So in Jason's situation, they have two young children right now, babies. They will get support right away when we roll out this program. And we've said we want to transition.
Yeah, but they won't get spaces. They'll get the money.
They'll get the money.
And then have to go find the spaces if
there
is one.
If they're in one of those provinces where the spaces will be created in 5 years, there's nothing for them until their kid's already in junior kindergarten.
Jason wants back in. Jason, go ahead.
Again, I'm kind of hoping to know what your definition of the low income bracket is. Where is your cutoff?
It would be the folks that are in the lowest income tax bracket, which I don't think in your case as a teacher you would be, Jason. I'm just being honest with you.
Can you please put a number to the top of the lower income tax bracket? How much are those families bringing home every year?
It's very low. It'd be in the $30,000 dollar range.
Jason, I don't know if you were satisfied. Were you satisfied with any of that? Did it help you in any way? You could be honest.
It sounds like the conservative plan's not really targeted towards me or people like me.
Okay. All right, Jason, thank you for that. We're going to get to our next voter. Here we go.
Hi, my name is Taylor. I'm a 40-year-old transgender woman from Winnipeg, Manitoba. Born and raised, lived here my entire life. I'm a data analyst. I've worked out of the same company for just over 10 years now. Love playing sports, especially softball, as you can tell. Fitness, too, obviously, is important to me. And for fun, you can find me singing karaoke. I always like to sing a song, too. I'm an undecided voter because I want to know more about what is going to be done to end bigotry and hate-based abuse. Let's be leaders and role models for the rest of the world.
Taylor is in my hometown of Winnipeg.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to spend time with you. Listen, Canadians are increasingly intolerant towards two-spirit, transgender, and non-binary individuals, and Canada is not doing enough to give us the quality of living that we have the right to. With your party, how would you ensure that everybody agrees that we all have a right and we all are valid?
Well, Taylor, let me say, you are valid, and I will fight and stand up for you and your rights. And all I can do as leader is set that example and tone. What I try and do is engage in dialogue respectfully and to try and bring people to my point of view.
So let me, Taylor, ask whether there's actually evidence of that. I'm sure you know what I'm going to ask about the conversion therapy ban. This was a piece of legislation that would make it illegal for people to be forced into conversion therapy to deny them or try to erase who they are. A majority of the Conservatives, 62 MPs, voted against that. You voted for it. You believe that the ban should go in place. If you are such a good leader, if you really can lead by example, convince people in your caucus this is the right way forward, is this not evidence that you can't do it?
Actually, it's not, Rosie, because when the bill first came, I spoke on it personally. It was introduced by a minister. I spoke as leader of the party. And our caucus was united on the fact that we wanted that type of harmful practice banned.
So what happened?
This was used, sadly, as a political wedge by Justin Trudeau, which is why the bill didn't pass.
If people like Taylor are to believe that your party is moving in a different direction or that you can lead them in a different direction, where is the evidence of that when we look at that particular piece of legislation?
The evidence is when we tried to work with the government. This is a good question to ask Mr. Trudeau because...
Well, I'm asking you. I've got him another day. I've got him another day.
Please ask him, because I don't think a community like the LGBTQ community, which Taylor said has already been subject to violence and intimidation and threats, should be used as a political debate wedge in Ottawa.
Well, it wasn't just a wedge. It was an actual issue.
We could have passed that bill before Christmas, Rosie. We could have passed that bill before Christmas.
Let me ask one more question. Systemic racism, it does not appear in your party's platform. You've been asked about it on the campaign trail. That seems strange to me. We have issues of systemic racism in this country. Do you believe we have issues of systemic racism that we need to deal with? And if you do, why wouldn't you put it in your platform?
We have found systemic racism in our justice system, particularly with criminal sentencing. And we will tackle inequalities, Islamophobia, racism, anti-Semitism. We will play a leadership role, as we should.
That's good to hear. But again, if things matter to you, why don't you write them down? You keep saying that this is your plan, this is your contract with people, and yet you don't seem to place a priority on those issues, or enough of a priority to put them in
there. I don't think that's fair. After the worst health and economic crisis in our national history, yes, Canada's recovery plan is largely based on getting people back to work, but that doesn't mean we don't want to be part of fighting back against intolerance, which I've called the sort of shadow pandemic within COVID-19 has been the rise in hate crimes and intolerance. We've got to all play a role fighting that.
Okay, Taylor, thank you for that question. When we come back, more Face to Face on The National. Welcome back to Face to Face. Let's get to the next questioner.
Hi, everyone. My name is Arslan Gaimi. I'm 22 years old, and I'm a debate and public speaking instructor at an academy called FDT in beautiful Vancouver, British Columbia. I'm an alumnus of UBC, where I studied political science. I'm an avid fan of Canadian politics, an often disappointed fan of the Canucks, and most importantly, I am an undecided voter. There are a couple of issues that are important to me. As a young person living in Vancouver, housing prices are always front of mind. I'm looking for a party with real solutions rather than gimmicks. As a racialized Canadian, as an immigrant, I have benefited greatly from the generosity of Canadians. So I'm looking for party leaders that will keep Canada open to the world.
Arsalan, that's great. I want to make sure that people know that there's a whole Zoom audience there too, and apparently they're being very vocal and reacting, waving, and so we just want to make sure that people know that there's other people watching with us as well, and we appreciate you being here too. Okay, Arsalan, your time starts now.
Hi, Mr. O'Toole. For me and for almost all of my friends, the number one question on our mind is, will we ever be able to afford a home in this city and increasingly in this country? So my question is simple. What would a conservative government do to make housing more affordable and to allow my generation to be able to build and grow our wealth as our parents and our grandparents were able to do?
Well, thank you, Arsalan. This is one of the most important issues facing our country, because I don't want your generation to have to give up on that expectation that you work hard, you finish UBC, a great school, and you'll never be able to afford a place to live in your own community. So what did I do as leader? I put one of our MPs, who's a millennial from the Fraser Valley, Brad Viss, and I said I wanted the best plan we've ever put out on housing, an area we haven't always put forward really strong ideas. And we launched it, and it's going to play our role, because as you know, there's a municipal, provincial, and federal role. We're going to ban for 2 years foreign buying by non-residents. As you know, in Vancouver, the Tri-Cities, it has been driving the whole Lower Mainland crazy, locking up money for someone that's not going to help build our communities. We're going to ban that for 2 years to try and take some pressure off. We're going to free up federal lands, 15%. We're going to tie transit and infrastructure type investments to density outcomes and hold our municipal and provincial friends to push out more density. We're going to let first-time home buyers have longer mortgage terms, so you can lock in not just for a 4 or 5 year interest rate term. We want you to be able to get out to 8, 9, 10 years so that you can plan and make sure first-time buyer programs fit all markets. They don't exclude Vancouver, Lower Mainland, or the GTA where we're sitting right now.
If I could, you know, it's rare they have a moment with a federal leader this way. The comment I just wanted to make is many parties often have relatively short-term demand-side solutions that put more money in people's pockets but don't solve the underlying supply problem, right? So it drives up the prices. So I think the commitment I would love is that it is difficult and hard to build more supply. It might even be expensive, and the federal government might have to intervene more than you'd be comfortable with to expand supply dramatically over the next 15, 20 years. Are you willing to sort of commit to those, you know, deeply rooted long-term solutions that really solve the supply problems rather than a short-term solution that, you know, throws a few bucks at people but doesn't solve the underlying cause?
Absolutely. In fact, that's why for the first time in generations, we will revisit mortgages and how they're even structured. It's why we're willing to give up 15% of Crown land and building holdings to try and do our part to actually give a little bit more supply directly. I want to change the dialogue here, because your generation is going to be held back because it's not the 1970s or 80s anymore. We have to reflect the reality your generation is facing. And the federal government is a key player, but not the only one. So this is another reason why we need less Mr. Trudeau dictating to everyone. We need more partnerships here.
Arsalan, got another one?
Yeah, I wanted to, if I could, just transition to a different question that a lot of my friends have asked me to ask, which is, I am from Iran. I have plenty of friends from the country of Afghanistan, and I've personally been sort of unbelievably distraught and, you know, relatively disappointed in the government of Canada's response to our obligations in that country. So the commitment I wanted to get from you, if I could, is that first, Mr. Trudeau is committed to accepting 40,000 refugees. I'm wondering if you would maintain that commitment and whether you would expand on that commitment to make sure those to whom we've made promises and those who are vulnerable in that country get the help that they deserve from a country like Canada.
Yes. And Arsalan, I held Mr. Trudeau to account, or tried to, on this. This is an area where he's failed. And to think there were 1,200 Canadians in Afghanistan needing to be brought home, hundreds of contractors and interpreters, and he called an election. I will never, ever have an approach of putting my political interests ahead of the well-being of others. We've got to stand by people who stood by us.
Arsalan, I'm just going to jump in if I can. So 40,000 Afghan refugees, do you commit to that number as well?
Well, the priority we wanted is everyone that was at risk needs to get out quickly.
Yeah, but that's the Liberals' priority too. They're going to bring everybody out, and then they've got 40,000 on top of that.
Absolutely. And what we've said is we have to make sure our refugee program always accelerates people that are at risk for persecution.
When we come back, more face-to-face on The National. Welcome back to Face-to-Face. Let's get to the next questioner.
Hi, I'm Grace. I'm 26 years old, and I live in Edmonton, Alberta. I first came to Canada when I was 4 years old with my parents. I grew up in BC, but I've lived in Alberta for a very long time, and I'm the oldest sibling of three. For this election, I feel very undecided. There's so many issues facing Canadians and our country, from the pandemic, cost of living, climate change, and more. And so I'll be basing my vote around the kind of government that we will elect, because that'll be hugely important to the steps we do or don't take in confronting our biggest challenges. My question to the leader of the Conservatives is around the party that he leads and what kind of government him and that party will form if they are to win.
Okay, Grace, over to you.
Hi, Grace.
Hi, thank you so much for speaking with me. My question is, given that your party and some of its members have, in some cases in the past, taken some very different positions, how will you, if you form government, handle party or even caucus members who may feel your views aren't conservative enough?
Well, great question, Grace. I said when I won the leadership, I wanted to grow the Conservative Party and movement. I wanted more people to see themselves reflected. I said I want more people staring in the mirror on election day and seeing a Conservative staring back, and we'll see on September 20th if that's going to be a reality.
The plan that you put forward this year for climate change is the first time that the Conservatives have a plan that includes carbon pricing. So just using that as an example of perhaps a more delicate issue within the party, how will you kind of deal with that as Prime Minister once it's no longer a matter of campaigning, but the Conservatives are actually to become the governing party?
Great question. So what I've tried to do, particularly for the thousands of families in northern Alberta, in Edmonton, and you would see it firsthand, Grace, there's economic challenges. How can we make sure we have a world-class resource sector that is getting emissions down, that we get our emissions down to meet our Paris targets without the economic destruction and dislocation we're seeing right now with the Trudeau plan? So what we did is we went and found the best climate change consultants in the country and worked with them and a range of stakeholders to try and come up with a plan to price carbon, get emissions down, but minimize the economic impact. We have a lot of things in the plan beyond the carbon price and the low carbon savings account, electric vehicles, hydrogen, small modular reactors. But this is an area where we have to win some trust. We need to meet our targets, but also have a strong economy, or we can't fight climate change if we don't have a strong economy.
So I'll ask a question here too, Grace, if you don't mind. We've heard you say that Justin Trudeau's emissions targets are meaningless because he doesn't hit them.
I've never said meaningless. I said he will say what he needs to,
okay,
and then doesn't achieve them.
Fine. Where you are going to hit yours, this is what you say. So let's say you do hit them. You do hit the previous targets because they're no longer the ones that we have in the world. I guess that sort of leaves the question, where is your ambition? Why not have targets that you seek to meet instead of ones that we know that we will meet? Because most people believe that we are now going to meet the emissions, the 30%, right, by 2036.
Well, you judge future behavior by past behavior. 6 years of Mr. Trudeau, he's never made a target. He's now saying he's going to hit a home run, Rosie. He's not even in the ballpark or dressed to bat yet. What I've said is we will achieve our Paris commitments.
But those are the previous Paris
commitments.
Then
you can show
we
ambition.
Now have new ones, right?
Mr. Trudeau changed his targets
The
twice.
World changed their targets. The world
Mr.
changed
Mr. Trudeau
their targets.
Changed Canada's targets
You have to update
twice.
The targets after 2 years.
In the 10 days after we released our plan. None of our allies have met their targets in the long term either. Okay. So what we have to do is make sure we deliver.
You say often that Justin Trudeau says one thing and does another. As Grace has pointed out, the same thing could be said of you. In a survey of Conservative leadership candidates by the National Firearms, you said you would conduct a line-by-line review of the Firearms Act and that you supported repealing several gun laws. You then said that you were going to repeal the order in council by the Liberals for 1,500 weapons that they put on a list. You now say, no, all firearms that are currently banned will remain banned and we're going to review it. How does that work? You do understand that you have a credibility issue on this.
I want people to know that we're going to keep the restrictions in place now, in place. Public safety is important for me.
You can't keep the restrictions in place and repeal the ban. Those two things don't work together, Mr. O'Toole.
Right, we're keeping the restrictions in place. Let's go after what is really leading to the rise in shootings in cities, which is the illegal smuggling. We live above a country with a lot of firearms, and we have to really work hard to keep them out of Canada because we have a much different system.
But how is restricting the Beretta Storm weapon used at the Dawson College shooting, for instance, how is that political?
Even in the Dawson situation, yes, I believe it was an illegally obtained firearm. So what we have to do is stop that from happening. 90% of firearms used in offenses are illegally obtained from the United States.
But surely restrictions on having the guns here would help as well.
I think we have, that's why we've said we're keeping the restrictions in place.
For how
long?
We're going
to try and take the politics.
How long will that take, that review?
We're going to let the review run. It will be independent because this is something that politicians should not be interfering with.
It's never going to be independent. The people on the review board are going to be people named by you.
No, I've said it will be public and there'll be representation from all parties and all groups.
When we come back, more face-to-face on The National. Two more questions, if I can, on mandatory vaccines. Why not require people to be vaccinated to get on a plane or a train? You're vaccinated, I'm vaccinated. Why should I have to go on a plane and worry if the person next to me is or isn't? Why is that person who won't get it done, and you want people to get vaccinated, you've said it, why is it their right to come on a plane or a train and it's not mine?
I want to get to herd immunity. I want to get to the 90% level. We recently announced a way that we think we can do that. And as you know, my wife and I had COVID. We videoed our vaccination.
Yeah, everyone videoed
it.
That's not what I'm asking you. I'm asking you, what is the big deal with telling people that they can't do everything they want if they're not vaccinated?
Because we have to respect people making the decision for themselves. We have to educate, we have to inform, and even the way you're describing it, Rosie, is almost them versus us. And in a pandemic,
it's not them versus us, but
we have to work together.
It's about safety. It's about safety,
absolutely,
public safety.
Absolutely.
So why should the person who's not making the choice for the collective safety be allowed to impose their choice on the people that did?
And if that
person
person comes from a background that has historical discrimination within our health system, we've seen that there's higher levels of hesitancy in people of color, in Indigenous Canadians, and the way we tackle that, Rosie, is not by fighting, it's by uniting. And so I was glad when Jagmeet Singh said, let's have all the leaders come together and do a video. I was the first to say yes. I want to respect people's decision here,
yes,
but also use rapid testing and screening, masking, everything to keep safe.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Thank you again to the voters. That's this special edition of The National.